may be a small crowd, but we can be loud.
Amen.
Well, welcome everybody. If we have any visitors today, welcome you. Does anybody have any prayer requests?
I do. Let's remember my mom's best friend Barbara. She loves it all of Thursday evening. Pray for Betty. And pray for me because
y'all shall rise. Oh, our glory.
She had a good song planned that would wake everybody up because this time change. Say, aren't you glad that where we're going, there'll be time no more?
Amen. Yeah.
I'm sick of these time changes. They mess everybody up. I just wonder how many people didn't hear it announced this time. Seems like every year there's less and less of announcement about it, right? But I hope that this song blesses you, heart. You know, this is the month of Thanksgiving, and we think of what we're thankful for.
Amen.
And I could go down a list of things that God has blessed me and I've been thankful for. And I guess personally, my health, He's restored me so many times. I was just telling Sister Carrie, since 1980, I've had 15 orthopedic surgeries.
Oh,
but God has been good to me, brought me through all of this.
Amen.
And I'm still here.
Amen.
Amen.
A lot of my friends that I grew up with, they're not here any longer. Some of them are in heaven. And one in particular reminds me of Brother Pat here. He was a tall friend of mine, played guitar so pretty. And he was the lead singer, and I was his backup. Now, I don't know, he went on to glory. But you know what the last thing he did was he got up into a big church down in Austin, Texas, where he had moved, and he did a hymn and played his guitar, looked similar to Pat's guitar, to that hymn, went back and sat down, and just a few moments later, he was in the arms of Jesus.
Wow. Oh, wow. What a way to go.
And the last thing he did was a good thing, so I guess I have to forgive him for leaving me. But pray for him. I'm trying to do this song. Might need to turn the volume up a little bit. I recorded it kind of low, but I'm not too sure about the leveling of the sound. But it's a song that I want to thank God that Jesus went to the cross
Amen.
Stretch forth his hands.
Yes.
Yeah.
And died for me. Stretch forth. And I know today all my sins are forgiven.
Amen. That's
I'm rapture ready. Love the Lord. I want to see as many people as I can go to heaven.
That's right.
Yeah.
And I know you're the same way. God bless you. Thank you for making us welcome here. We're so blessed here. The messages have touched your heart. Little Natalie says the preacher's message. It touched my heart.
Wow.
And Lord, and I love to hear that.
Amen.
I love to hear it when God is working.
Amen.
Amen.
Shook the floor, and I said, "Can I help you, sir?"
with a voice that I guess ain't frail. And he looked at me with a sneering grin. He said, I want to buy some big nails. Well, three old rusty spikes is all I had. He said to me, that'll do. For the job I had, three's enough. Now, how much do I owe you? Well, he put the money in my hand, and I was glad to make the sale. And then I wondered, and I asked him, sir, what can you do with just three nails? And he said, did you ever hear of a man called Jesus the Nazarene? Oh, you've been the one that goes about doing good. He said, yes, that's the man. Well, today I intend to show the world that I'm boss. For with these three old rusty spikes, I'm going to nail Jesus to the cross. Well, I stood there almost numb, and you'll never know how I felt. And I said, please, sir, don't do that. It was on my knees I nailed him. He just turned and he walked away. And I got up and I followed him. And I said, please, sir, I'll buy them back. But he just looked at me and he grinned. But in the distance, I could see the howling mob through tears that filled my eyes. Away with him! Crucify him! I could hear their angry cries. And over the top of all the noise and the groans of agony, I could hear the sounds of that hammer as that big Roman soldier nailed Jesus to the tree. With three rusty nails, they nailed Jesus to the tree. The sun, it turned to darkness on that day. It was the day that Jesus died, and the blood flowed from his side. The blood that washed my sin away. Jesus cried, forgive them, Lord, for they know not what they do. For they have strayed so far, far away. With three rusty nails, they took Jesus' precious blood, the blood that washed my sin away. Well, they laughed as he cried, the soldiers pierced his naked side.
Sun shining rain, even that's so true.
Good morning, shake someone's hand, tell them to get me in the house.
Good morning, how's it going? Pass it on forward.
Be friendly, you need to hurry.
We are blessed.
Good to see you.
Good to see you. You want a hug?
The only time he can get away with giving hugs is when he's at church.
Thank you, God.
You're welcome.
You ain't with him all the time, sister.
I know. That's what he's saying. That's all right. He comes home to mama.
There you go.
Turn with me to Genesis chapter 18 this morning. Go back to the first book. Remind us of some things that took place here that I think we need to take a good look at and see where our lives are. Make sure that we're not like the world. Make sure that we're not giving in to things. Because the devil's fighting every one of us. Now, you believe it or not, you can say the devil don't bother me. He bothers every one of us. I mean, he's trying to pull us down, destroy us any way he can. He does it through sometimes through different ways. And all of you know those ways. I know most of you are. Older in the Lord, and most of you know some of the tricks of the devil, but he tries to destroy our relationship with God. He did it with a lot of people through the Word. God has blessed us, as she just said. We are blessed, and we're blessed beyond compare. God has honored us and lifted us up in a world that is corrupt, a world that is it's a stinking world right now because the devil is taking control and he's trying to lead and guide, but we know who's in control. It's God. The devil is just trying to say he's in control, but he's not in control. He's only got a little fingertip in here. Praise God, we got a God that's using this old earth for his footstool. And praise God, he's taking care of us. And I thank God for that. But as you look around, you don't see a lot of people that are, forgive me, really serving God.
Lord, help us.
We see a lot of people that claim Christianity. We see a lot of people that claim to live right. We see a lot of people that talk about living right. But whenever it gets right down to where the rubber on the
road,
they squished out because they ain't meet the road. They're not exactly where they need to be with God. People get up on the street corners and they holler and carry on saying they want people saved and they're not living right. That's not right. People that tell you how to live and they're not living right themselves, that's not right. But we have a lot of people that do that. We have a lot of people that talk about it. We have a lot of people that talk about living right, talk about serving God, and their heart's far from it. You can't only serve God with your vocal cords.
That's right.
Before I get too far along, any of you that have something to read next week, we're going to honor our veterans here next week, so any of you that have something you'd like to read, bring it, and we'll try and have a service here honoring our veterans. There's some of them here, and praise God for you that serve. But the devil is trying to destroy the relationship that we have with God, and the way he does that is by pulling our minds in a different direction. He did that with this man here. But God's always got somebody that's praying for us. God's always got somebody that's interceding for us. Doesn't mean that we're still going to heaven. Doesn't mean that we're still going to make it. Because we have got to make up our minds whom we're going to serve. We've got to get our hearts in tune with God. We've got to make sure that we're serving God. We've got to make sure that we're doing what God's called. Just because somebody's praying for you don't mean you're going to go to heaven. You got a good praying grandmother, she's praying for the grandkids and all this. That don't mean the grandkids are going to heaven.
That's right.
They've got a choice themselves. Abraham here was a man of God, and God was using him. And he was blessing him. He was blessing his flock and blessing all the animals that he owned. And he had great flocks. had his son, had his brother's son with him, which would have been Lot. And him and Lot were living together in an area that became too confined for all the animals they had. And the herdsmen started fighting over the land. They wanted their flock to look the best, and they wanted theirs to be the fattest. I remember, and I'll tell you this and I'll go on, but I remember that we went up to see my uncle one time, Uncle Muntz, and he had a brother named Dick that was deaf and dumb. And we went out to watch him feed the horses. Well, he'd give his horses 2 or 3 ears of corn, and maybe give Muntz's 1 ear of corn. He'd give his horse a big block of hay, and maybe give Muntz's a half a piece of hay. He took care of his flock better than he did others. But these flock, I thought that was funny. We watched him do it. But he really took care of his. Now, he loved his animals, no doubt about that. He was going to make sure they were fat and pretty. And every one of them, everybody I ever seen him on, was fat and pretty. He could not talk, and he'd get behind those mules or horses, whatever which one he had at the time, and he'd go, bye bye, and they would know exactly which way to go, right or left. He'd do another signal. They'd know exactly what to do. Couldn't speak a word, but they knew exactly who was in charge. And as I say that, these herdsmen, they wanted their flocks to be the best. And, you know, all of us do. Whenever we got a job, I mean, if we're really doing what we are supposed to, then we want our jobs to shine. We want people to see us for doing our jobs. And they got where they were fighting over the land because they wanted a better place to graze. And they would fight and find a good place to graze. And then somebody else would come in and try and take it away from them. So Abraham and Lot looked at the problem, and they decided, well, we're going to have to separate. We're going to have to go in our own different directions. And whenever they did, all of you know that Lot looked towards Gomorrah, and he decided that he'd send his flock that way. The decisions we make in life need to be prayed about. They need to be sought before God. You might have a little decision that you're going to make in the morning. And you might say, well, you know, I can handle this decision on my own. But really, can you handle any decision without God?
Nope.
Not right.
Not right, can we? We need God to help us with every decision that we make, and we need His blessings upon it. We need to know that He's going to take us to the situation and help us with the situation and will bless the situation. And
amen.
I'm afraid that Lot didn't pray very much. I'm afraid whenever he set his tents towards Gomorrah, he didn't think a lot. And then there was another city named Samada. Lord have mercy. Sodom and Gomorrah, you know, they were close cities together. And you know that the city of there was, had sodomy in it. And it had taken over the land. Y'all forgive me this morning, but it's took over a lot of the land today. These gray gay activists, not gray, but gay activists out here marching in the streets and trying to take control of things. It's because there's a demon in the air. It's not because they were born that way.
That's right.
Nobody is born that way. It's because they make a life's choice to be that way. I believe in my heart that Jesus has created all of us, the man to love woman and woman to love man. Because He created Adam and Eve. He didn't create Adam and Steve. He didn't create Eve and Mary.
That's right.
He created man and woman.
Right.
And we're supposed to love. If we're going to have a woman, if you're a man, and a man, if you're a woman. And any other thing else is not of God. This world might say, well, you know, I still love God and I still care about God. You might love God, but you're not in love with God. Because if you're in love with God, you want to give up evil ways.
That's right.
Just painting you a picture this morning. I just want you to see where I'm coming from. Maybe whenever Lot looked out across there, maybe he didn't see all this turmoil and all the problems that were there. But I'm going to tell you something. We get up in the mornings and we look out at the world, and maybe we're not seeing all the turmoil and all the things that are going on in our world either. Maybe sometimes we think, because it's my child or it's not my child, then it's none of my business. Well, I'm about my Father's business.
Amen.
And I'm supposed to pray over those things. Some words or another, Lot had lost his first love, because I don't believe he was praying over the right things. Does he wouldn't have never pitched his tent that way, because God would have warned him that there's danger ahead. Whenever you go on a trip, I hope every one of you pray before you go. If you're going on a long trip, you need to pray and ask God to send you in the right direction. I think whenever we went to Michigan, and I prayed before I left, because I hadn't driven that far since I'd had COVID, and it was a long drive, and I knew that I probably ended up doing most of it. And I saw one car stop getting a ticket up there and all the way back. No wrecks,
wow.
No nothing.
Praise God.
You see, that's God. Mm-hmm. And God gives us safe travel. God blesses us with things. God blesses you in your home.
Yes, He does.
God loves you, but you see, we need to pray first and ask God, what is your will, God? And Lot got himself in a mess. He got caught up in what was going on in Sodom. He got caught up with what was going on in Sodom and Gomorrah, and he messing with it, and he got entangled with it. And whatever he did, he was a part of it. Now God let Abraham know he was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. Whenever he let him know that he was going to destroy it, Abraham got upset, and he felt like he needed to pray. He felt like he needed to talk to God. So I want to read here what he talked to God about. I want you to listen to this, because this is a man's love for his nephew. This is a man's love for his family. And verse 18. And the men rose up from thence and looked toward Sodom, and Abraham went with them to bring them on the way. And the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham that thing which I do, seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him? For I know him, that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he hath spoken of him. Now the Lord's not in question here. He knew what Abraham was going to do, because he knew he loved Lot. He knew he loved Lot's family. And he knew that Abraham was going to stand up for his family. How many of us in here today would stand up for our family? Every one of us would. Mm-hmm. We'd stand up and we'd say, God, we don't want them to be destroyed, but God, we want them to go to heaven. If there's any way, God, that we can see them suspended, God, we want it done. And God knew this. And the Lord said, because the cry of Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very grievous, I will go down now and see whether they have done altogether according to the cry of it, which is come unto me. And if not, I will know the men. And the men turned their faces from thence and went toward Sodom. But Abraham stood yet before the Lord. And Abraham drew near and said, will thou also destroy the righteous with the wicked? Peradventure there be 50 righteous within the city. Will thou also destroy and not spare the place of the 50 righteous that are in the city, or therein, that be far from thee to do after this manner, to slay the righteous with the wicked? And the righteous should be as the wicked, that be far from thee. Shall not the judge of all the earth do right? And the Lord said, if I find in Sodom 50 righteous within the city, then I will spare all the place for their sakes. And Abraham answered and said, behold, now I have taken upon me to speak unto the Lord, which am but dust and ashes. Peradventure there shall lack 5 of the 50 righteous. Wilt thou destroy all the city for the lack of 5? And he said, if I find there 45, I will not destroy it. And he spake unto him again, and said, peradventure there shall be 40 found there. And he said, I will not do it for the 40's sake. And he said unto him, oh, let not the Lord be angry, and I will speak. Peradventure there shall 30 be found there. And he said, I will not do it if I find 30 there. Man, these are great cities. And he's already got him down to 30 people. And he said, behold, I have spoken upon me to speak unto the Lord. Peradventure there be 20 found there. And he said, I will not destroy it for 20's sake. Now, I feel sure that in his heart, Abraham felt, well, Lot, I've got his 2 daughters that are virgins. I got his 2 daughters that are married. So now I've got 7 people I know. And he said, oh, let me not the Lord be angry, and I will speak yet but this once. Peradventure 10. So all we need is 3 more, shall be found there. And he said, I will not destroy it for 10's sake. And the Lord went his way as soon as he had left communing with Abraham, and Abraham returned to his place. But we all know that Abraham had not realized that even though Lot had been rich in goods and monies and things that God had blessed him with, that he had lost it all, even his soul. And as we think about that, and we look at our daily lives, and we think about, well, this person over here says they're going to go to heaven and they live this way, or they live with these things in their life, and they say they're going to heaven, so why can't I live like they do? Well, are you going to be Abraham or Lot? Mm-hmm. Who are you going to be? You know, we make the choice every day whom we're going to serve.
That's right.
And Joshua said, as far as me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. And I don't know what your decision is today, and I don't know how far along you are with your decision of what you're doing in your life. And I hope and pray that every one of you are living a life that is dedicated to God. I hope you have the presence of the Holy Ghost and the power of God moving up and down your spine each and every day. I hope that you're praying and seeking God's face. But Lot had got caught up in Sodom and Gomorrah. Mm-hmm. And God sent in the angels because of Abraham's prayer that he might escape the fire of Sodom and Gomorrah. He did not bring Lot out as a man of God. He brought him out because he had an uncle that had got a hold of God. He brought him out to give him another chance. He brought him out because God, of a man that he was honoring and lifting up, go make nations of nations of. He didn't want him to have a black heart for what God had done to him. And God wanted him to love him. And he brought his, was going to bring his nephew out. And whenever God sent the angels in, even the people that were in that land, the men went and seen these. Now all of you know, you've seen a bunch of plays, and all of you seen plays, and you've been in plays, and most of the time, everybody puts a woman in as an angel, or a young girl. Mm-hmm. Well, angels are men. The Word of God has not got one female angel. It's all, they're all men. I know people says, well, whenever my wife dies, she's an angel in heaven. Well, I beg to differ with you. She's not.
Amen.
She's not. She can't be an angel. She can be a child of the King.
Amen.
But she can't be an angel. I'm just telling you this morning, that whenever you talk to somebody, that you need to know what the Word of God says. You need to know how that Word of God works. And these men went in, and whenever they went in, the men of the city saw these men. And they were good-looking men because they were angels. And they wanted to have sex with these men. The men did. And Lot had to take them into his house and hide them. Why in the world? If you know God and you know God's blessings, why in the world would you want to live in such a place? Why in the world would you? It's because the devil is fighting us tooth and nail to have us to do the same things. Why in the world would somebody want to live in a house, can't pay their bills, can't afford anything because they're on drugs, because they're on alcohol, because they can't do the things that are right? Why in the world would this happen? Because there's a demon that's in the air that tries to get in your body to get you to despise God and love them and praise God. We need to serve this God with all.
Right.
Yeah.
The devil is alive and well. And he's trying to destroy the very elect. He was trying to destroy Lot here. He wanted to destroy the whole city. He wanted them to be with him. The devil don't want you to go to heaven.
Uh-uh.
He don't want you to walk on streets of gold.
No, he don't.
He wants you to go to hell where he can punish you forever. Because that's where he's got to go. He's already doomed to go there.
Amen.
And now he wants you to end up in the same place.
Yeah.
Well, all of you know that there wasn't 10 men in both of the cities, in the whole neighborhood, in the whole place. There wasn't 10 women. God forgive me, but there weren't 10 children. Because the husband and wife sanctify the children.
That's right.
People forget that. The reason there's sanctification in your house is because the husband and wife have sanctified the children. And if you're not right with God, you can't sanctify your child.
That's right.
Oh, what can you mean this morning?
It's true.
No, I'm bringing to remembrance. And this is not being mean. This is trying to tell you that the devil's trying to destroy your house. Maybe not through sodomy, but through alcohol, drugs, lying, cheating, stealing. He wants to destroy you in the same manner. And if he can do it, he'll tear you down and jerk the feet out from under you and get you ready to go to hell with him.
That's exactly right.
Because he is a stinking devil that despises what God has built up in these last days.
Right.
A group of people, not many left, I'm afraid to say it. I used to think that whenever Jesus comes back, Brother Tim, there's going to be a great crowd. Brother Ernest, I don't see the great crowd no more. I don't see the great number no more. I see few shall enter in. And that's what it talks about whenever it talks about the narrow path. Those that walk on the narrow path. Those that are not on the broad way. That's old-timey preaching right there, the narrow path. But I'm going to tell you something, honey. We need to get back to the old path. We need to get back to where we're walking close to God. We need to get back to the point to where this old world don't matter to us no more.
Amen.
And we're going to serve God no matter what everybody else in the world does. We're going to put God first in our life.
Amen.
Yeah.
sin.
Yeah.
Oh, Brother Ken, you're going to hurt some feelings. Praise God. You're going to have to hurt some feelings to get people saved.
Yeah.
I hate to say it, but we're going to have to. Mm-hmm. We've tried watering this thing down and white coating it and making it look pretty, but sin is sin, and you can't make it look good.
Amen.
Whenever it's finished, it's dirty and it stinks.
Yeah.
I've always said it was like cat. You, some of you might have cats in your house, but and you might have the best thing they ever made for a cat to go in. But praise God, whenever they go, it stinks. Don't matter how deep they covered, it still stinks. It's the worst stink you can have, in my mind. It stinks. And you can't cover it up enough to keep it from stinking. Sin's the same way. You can't cover it up enough to keep it from stinking. It'll stink to your bones. It'll stink to your heart. It'll stink in your mind because it's stinking. Thinking that destroys this world. It's thinking, thinking that people say, oh, I've got to accept people the way they are because that's what the world says. The world might take me and put me in jail for preaching it this morning, but I can tell you right now, I'm not going to accept it for the way it is.
Amen.
I'm going to serve God. I'm going to put God first in my life. I'm going to serve Him. And I'm going to heaven whether this world likes it or not.
Yeah.
Right. Glory.
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 Preaching.
Hello, 10 people. In all the cities. I was just wondering. This week, whenever God had given me this message, I was waking one night and I was thinking. And you start counting on your hand. Start counting in your head. You don't even need to pull off your shoes. Start thinking about the people you come in contact with. That you know that's going to heaven, there's no doubt in your mind.
You feeling that?
They're few and far between.
Yep.
Yeah.
Few and far between. People don't have their minds made up. They look out across a place there and they see a good city and they see things with bright lights, and they think, boy, I need some of that. You know what we really need? We need to be on our knees.
Yes.
Crying out to a God.
Amen.
Accepting Him and saying, Lord, I need you more than I need the next breath.
Amen.
We need to be crying out to Him and saying, God, help me to sustain from this evil that's in this land. When's the last time you prayed that? When's the last time you prayed, God, help me not to even let evil enter my mind. Don't let it enter my heart. When's the last time you prayed, God, help me to sustain the life of a Christian. God, help me to live this life pure and clean before you. When's the last time you really prayed that? Don't raise your hand, but I just want to know, and I want you to think about it because I want to tell you something. I believe sometimes we forget. We forget to inventory our own hearts,
mm-hmm.
our own soul, our own minds. And whenever we forget, we're like Lot. We might go out and point our tents in the wrong direction.
That's right. That's
right. Another woman that's not your wife or another man that's not your husband come up to you and start talking to you and telling you how good you look. I don't have to worry about that anymore, but how sweet you are. They think you got a little extra money. And they can destroy your life in seconds.
Yes, they can.
Thank you. The neighbor's teenager, son, come down to the house with the young girls. Can destroy the whole house in just a matter of minutes.
That's right.
Because we haven't prayed over them and put the cover and the hedge around them that Job had around him.
That's right.
We need to pray over these young people, teenagers and young people. We need to pray that God will put a hedge around them.
Yes.
That God will protect them.
And whenever they go out of the house, that God's anointing will go with them. You see, we're held accountable for every idle word that we say. We're also held accountable for the things that we don't do. And a lot of times we forget to pray. We forget to set our eyes on the gold. There's a goal we got our eyes on, brother. Heavenly streets.
That's right.
Yep.
Heavenly streets. Heavenly streets. We've got to go there. And if we're going to go there, then we're going to have to make up our minds up. Are we going to be like Abraham? Are we going to be the ones that's praying and seeking God's face for people? Are we going to be the one pulling them out of the fire? Are we going to be like Lot? Are we going to say, I want everybody in the church to love me? I want everybody in the church to care for me. So therefore, I'm not going to say nothing to them if they're doing something wrong. I'm not going to say that what you're doing is going to send you to hell. I'm not going to tell them that. But what I'm going to do is pat them on the shoulder and say, you'll be all right. It's time that we come up to what God's standard is.
Amen.
And say, may God help you. May God bless you. But what you're doing is going to send you to hell. You say, look, and that's hard. If we don't tell them, who is
He's going to? That's right.
Who is going to tell them? Who is going to tell them? You think the world's going to tell them?
Nope.
They don't care where you spend eternity. They don't want you to go to hell. They don't care about you going to hell. They don't care if you go to hell. You think the drug dealer down the road is worried about you going to heaven?
No.
All he's worried about is getting somebody else fixed up on the drug fix.
That's right.
The ABC store opens up uptown and they're not worried about your soul.
Nope.
All they're worried about is somebody buys their product where they keep their job. Yep. Those people that you come in contact with that don't know Jesus, they're not worried about where you spend eternity.
Nope.
All they're worried about is what they can obtain from you. Because there's a devil that's working in their minds,
yep,
their soul, and their hearts. We need to stop and think. We need to look at some of these old messages and really see and really stop and think. How am I living? God, how do I stand up before you? God, would I be found to be righteous? One righteous? God, would there be one righteous in my house or two righteous in my house? God, where do we stand? Where do we stand? All businesses uptown, probably where you work at, they do an inventory. They make sure that they've got the money in the bank to cover what they own and everything. They put it all together and then they know what they're worth. If you were inventoried before God, how would you be found? Would you be found on the righteous side? Or the demonic side. I think we need to inventory our souls sometimes.
Amen.
And really see where we'd be found.
Sorry.
Because Jesus is coming. Stand. Simple. This morning that it was all right to preach on the clothesline.
if I preach true, born again salvation from God, don't take this wrong. If I preach the undefiled word of God, I don't have to say a word about the clothesline. Because next time you get something out of the wardrobe, it's going to show parts that shouldn't be shown.
Conviction, come on.
There's a Holy Spirit.
Amen. Yeah.
That's going to convict you.
Yep.
Nothing wrong with saying something about it every now and then. God, I always say something about it. In the first of summer, whenever these young girls, I see them out and they got short shorts up to where their arms is longer than their shorts.
Yeah.
Amen.
I do say something about those things. Don't get me wrong. Because you'll see them going around. There ain't no cloth there you can't get it down no lower. But if you're going to serve God, God's going to convict your heart.
Right.
God's going to let you know where you're wrong at. God will bring you back in line.
Thank you, Jesus.
But the reason people have to preach the clothesline is because they don't preach the salvation in the way they need to. They don't preach that pure, undefiled word of God that we go to clean up and serve Him and put Him first in our life and let the holy anointing flow from us to somebody else.
That's right.
If you're here this morning and God spoke to your heart and you need to be in the altar, I expect you to come as we pray this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you this morning, Lord, I love you and I praise you, Lord, for the word, God. God, take this word and fit it to every heart, God. God, you know the needs here this morning, Lord. And Lord, I hope it stirred some hearts, God, that they'll do some thinking, God. Think about where they're going to pitch their tents. Think about where they're going to serve God.
Yeah.
Think about who really they love.
Yeah.
And God will give you the honor, the praise, and the glory for the word. If there be one that wants to pray, you're welcome to come. Won't you come? Jesus, I love you this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings. God, I honor you this morning. Glory be God. In Jesus' precious and holy name I pray. Amen and amen. Thank you, Lord. Shake hands and be friendly. You're dismissed.